Hello YouTube and welcome to Heathen Hacks. Today's video is going to include my annual PC cleaning process, which was supposed to be done last January, but due to lack of time it was postponed again and again until February 4. After cleaning, we're going to replace the stock Corsair 8-pin and 24-pin power cables with a custom aftermarket one for a better aesthetic look. And then, we're going to unbox and set up a Corsair Lighting Node Pro to add some more RGBs on my system. Also, just like on my other newer videos, I will provide the timestamps as well, so if you don't feel like watching the cleaning process, you can skip it. So, without further ado, let's go! This is different from my weekly cleaning method where I just clean the front intake filter, polish the tempered glass a little, and then clean the keyboard and monitors. No. This time we're going to go deep. We're going to remove the dust from every nooks and crannies of the case and components. I will also show you the things I use to clean them. I haven't cleaned this for about a little over 6 months, by the way. So at this point, I have already cleaned the keyboard and my 3 monitors. They are currently in a different room. You could also click right here if you want to see my effortless mechanical keyboard cleaning process. Now let's see how dusty the inside of the case is. Look at that!
Damn!
Okay, first up, let's clean the tempered glass side panels. To do that, I'm going to use this glass cleaner together with a microfiber cloth. See, this is for car windows and according to where I bought it from, it's safe to use on tempered glass. And since this is safe to use on glass coatings as well, it won't be a problem for my tinted side panels. After cleaning the side panels and placing them in a different room to avoid accidents, take a look at this front intake filter though. I'm going to clean it outside using this paintbrush. Yes, that's right, no need for an air compressor, compressed air in a can, or a vacuum cleaner. A simple non-static paintbrush would do just fine. It's far better for the environment too. There's this article that was posted by the EPA or Environmental Protection Agency that says compressed air or canned air, although not using CFCs or chlorofluorocarbons because the use of it was banned for over a decade, still use a particular class of GHGs or greenhouse gas, referred to as hydrofluorocarbons or HFCs as the propellant. Now, I'm no scientist and the article was published last 2012, so I'm not sure if it's still applicable today. I just thought it was interesting. Here it is after cleaning. Now let's move on to the intake fans. First, disconnect them from the Commander Pro and LED hub.
I don't want to share the earth with that thing. I feel dirty. Oh.
Well, there you go. It's all clean now. I started by brushing it with my handy dandy paintbrush and then switched to a smaller sized brush to brush off the dust on hard to reach places. And just to be thorough, I used my air blower as well. Next on the cleanup order is the back exhaust fan. This is its current dust accumulation. I used the same method I did with the front intake fans to clean it, after disconnecting it from the Commander Pro and LED hub. Moving on to the GPU. As you can see here, the dust buildup is at the back of the fans, which is hard to clean by just using a brush. But I have found a way to clean them by using a brush and without dismantling it completely and voiding the warranty. For this method of cleaning, you have to be careful or you could end up with a GPU that has a broken fan. The way I clean them is by removing the fan screws that are located here, here, and here. After removing the screws, I lifted the fans like this. Then again, clean them using my brush and a microfiber cloth. Continuing on to the radiators. Same thing with the front intake fans, I cleaned the ML140s using my brush, the radiator using my air blower, and the pump using a microfiber cloth. So now that the cleaning is done, it's time to install the aftermarket custom power supply cables for the GPU and motherboard. Here it is. I have already cleaned the radiator together with its fans and pump. The 24-pin custom cable is also already attached to the motherboard. This time, I'm going to install the CPU. As you can see here, the CPU's heat spreader has a lot of scratches. The AIO's cold plate has a lot of those too. That's because of Thermal Grizzly's Cryonaut Thermal Paste. Kinda wish that I have known about that issue before buying and using one, but oh well. Guess I just have to switch to an NTH1 or MX4 next time I clean my rig, but for now, I would use the remaining Cryonaut Thermal Paste that I have. 1 gram of this is just 1 to 3 applications if I remember correctly. Now let's attach the pump. Tighten it with just the right amount of resistance, then connect it to the motherboard via USB header. After that, let's put the GPU back to its rightful place, then connect the custom cables for it. So I've just attached the custom cables and routed them all to the back of the case. Look at that chaos though. Now, before we finalize the wire management, let's unbox the Corsair Lighting Node Pro. Here's the box. Inside the box is the Lighting Node Pro itself with the SATA power connector to get power from the PSU with an included double-sided tape. The 4 RGB strips. Each RGB strip has 10 ARGB LEDs and a length of a little over 16.5 inches including the RGB wires. A total of about 11.5 inches without the wires, and the LEDs are just a little over an inch apart from each other. What else do we have in here? Some instruction manual and warranty stuff as usual. The mini USB Type B to USB 2.0 header that would be connected to either a Commander Pro or motherboard for IQ control. 3 pairs of ARGB LED extension cables and this thing. Don't know what it is since it's both a female connector and only has 2 wires. Let's take a look at the chaos of wires one last time. And here it is, my barely clean cable management. It may look like a rat's nest, but I know what cable is connected to what component, so no worries. And besides, this is not a showpiece and nobody would know anyway. Well, except you guys who are watching this video, I guess. The RGB strip connections are like this. LED strip 1 or LED 1A is located at the top of the case. LED 1B or strip number 2 is at the front. LED 2A is at the back and LED 2B is at the bottom. Here's a simple wiring diagram that I have made just in case you wanted to see how everything is connected. Okay, so here's a quick demonstration on how I set them up. This is my most used RGB profile called Mirror Plus Macros, which I mostly use for work and normal internet browsing. As you can see here, just to see the effects clearly, the only things that are lit are the Lighting Node Pro LED strips. Now this is for the color shift key. Type light, project nova, nova, gradient, wave ripple. I really like the sort of mirror effect here, where the colors are going in opposite directions. Grink or green and pink. Next is opposites, sequential wave key, static blue, static turquoise, static red, lava orange. I have added a lighter shade of orange that sort of flickers here to symbolize the lava. Oh, by the way, this Gigabyte logo here is controlled by RGB Fusion and I can turn it off and on anytime I want. But I just want it to be a static color of green at the moment. This is static hot pink, static white, 3D, visor key, white rain. For this one, just like on lava orange, I have added a sort of flicker, but this time to symbolize lightning strikes, Philippine flag, and the pride flag. Well, that's pretty much it. Now for the review. The Corsair Lighting Node Pro is a nice case addition. However, if we compare its price to, let's say, the Fantex Neon RGB LED strip combo, the Fantex one is the clear winner here. In my opinion, the one from Fantex just looks better. Now, it is true that the Lighting Node Pro has more RGB LED strips compared to the Fantex one. But, in terms of LED count per strip, Fantex comes out on top again. Its 400mm LED strip has 28 LEDs, while the Lighting Node Pro strips only have 10 each. And for its price, you can buy 2 pairs of them and it would still be cheaper than the Lighting Node Pro. But, and this is the big but here, although Corsair's Lighting Node Pro has a heftier price and inferior looks, Corsair certainly wins in terms of its control software, IQ. It's also a huge plus for me, since most of my components are Corsair and I can control all of their RGB effects in one software. It's just more centralized that way in my opinion. Then again, the Fantex one looks really tempting. Maybe I'd check those out in the future. And now, this. Thanks for watching and see you again next week. Maybe.